Miami is a major transportation center and is easily reached by all forms of travel. The Latin American influence has given Miami a unique flavor.
DEA agents say the days of South Florida's cocaine cowboys are over.
The Colombians realized they had a gold mine here. Everybody that before was doing these pot things was now into doing cocaine.
It's a U.S. gateway for narcotics traffic from South America and the Caribbean.
This is a throwback to the 80s when we had the cocaine cowboys.
It's like Scarface, but it's different because it's not like the movies, it's the real shit.
Scooby Williams is
brand new for us in the 90s now that we haven't experienced this in the last few years.
Everybody always thought Miami was just the palm trees. We was telling you, don't get the palm trees confused at all. You know what I'm saying? Nah, it's real life.
Haitian ships were sometimes known to smuggle large quantities of Colombian narcotics into the port of Miami.
This is the Port of Miami 10-year anniversary special. Everybody wants to know, as a new artist, how did you actually get all those artists and producers on board?
You know, I think it was just really, you know, our hustle. Everybody knowing it was real. Everybody, whoever came through Miami, know, you know what I'm saying? You seen Rose, E-Class, you seen the whole squad. They knew we was really out there. So, you know, if they was really rocking, they was going to rock with us. And, you know, we salute that. We'll never forget that, you dig?
So how does it feel to be 10 years in the game, as strong as hell, you celebrating the Port of Miami? How does it feel? Like,
just on some G shit, man. Right. It feels wonderful, big homie.
Right.
Oh, Port of Miami is a classic. That's a classic. If you don't say that's a classic, you played yourself and you just a straight bay.
You know, Port of Miami, you know, that's Rick Ross, man. You know what I'm saying? So, and that's his first album ever.
When you're recording your first album and you're not thinking 10 years down the line. You just want to make a dope-ass album. That's what I was on, you know what I'm saying? I just wanted to make a dope-ass album. I just wanted my city name to be in
title. It's up there with all the great albums. Have to put it up there.
So, you know that Port of Miami album, every time I see that album cover, man, I feel good as fuck.
Miami. Many call it the capital of Latin America and the Caribbean. Some 100,000 Haitians call the city home.
I've been in Miami for about 14 years. I live in the Miramar area, Carroll City area. Rick Ross, DJ Khaled, we here forever. If we had to prove something, we proved it. When you made that 10-year mark, you proved it. And we just getting started.
I think the album Port of Miami is extremely important in hip-hop. It brought a new sound and Rick Ross himself, just a brand new swagger, like a real, you know, big, I feel like artists like that, they don't come around that often.
Port of Miami is very, 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 very important. That album was like the second chapter for me in Kool's career. You know, we you know, Fat Joe kind of ushered us into the game. And, you know, we did what we did with the game. But then, you know, the Rick Ross movement with us and Khaled was like chapter two for us.
Yeah, that don't change my life because, you know, my cousin Bo, who passed away 4 years ago, but we used to ride around to that joint, you know, all the time when I was trying to get on.
Rick Ross, I'm the boss, Port of Miami, go get it right now. If you don't have it, go get it. All the safe, I'm the best.
2006, Miami, the movement.
And you know, we call ourselves the movement. You know, that's Kool & Dre, that's DJ Khaled, that's Rick Ross, that's Po' Boy, that's Pitbull, that's Flo Rida.
Right now you're witnessing the movement, 305's finest.
That's when all the covers was coming. You know, Ross was on every cover. I remember doing a double XL with all of us in the cover. If you didn't know Miami, you won't know.
Rick Ross was just, you know, a force. Such a force that we ended up doing a record, Chevy Riding High, you know, just to put Ross on it. You know, I'm rapping on there, and we made the record just to put Ross on it because he was so on fire.
I got road dogs doing that 20 to life. You try me, and I'ma get 20 tonight. You think you bitch bad, boy, I got 20 a life.
Miami was the most dangerous place on earth.
Cocaine deaths in Dade County have now jumped to about 2 a week.
Shotguns, Uzi, handguns.
It was the beginning of a war.
I said any record I put out, I put him on it. You know what I'm saying? I just felt good being part of help breaking, because so many people besides himself was help breaking him to the whole national level.
There's DJs and there's
DJ Khaled. There's radio stations and there's 99 Jams. We are the number one radio station in the world. 99 Jams, let's go.
Me and Ross, in the very beginning, it was more of him coming to me as a artist that wanted to get his records played.
Fake niggas get taped up and sent back. Use a fake nigga, you makes up a good act. I wakes up, breaks up the crib sack. Ghost rap, but most nights I flip packs.
Ross was, you know, ripping it down in the local scene, doing his thing. He would do a bunch of freestyles. But I was just telling him, hey, they gotta be that thing, because they know when Khaled go hard, he go hard.
It's my brother, August 8th, go get his album, Port of Miami. It's gonna be the craziest album. Remember, I told you. When I tell you the truth. I put my whole career on it.
But I go hard because I gotta love it, but also the people gotta love it. Meaning as in, I feel their energy as much as I feel my energy.
You think it's a game? When I co-sign, I mean for real. Go cop an album, you don't cop it, don't ever talk to me.
But when Hustling came, E-Class gave me Hustling, and that's when I started. The first 15 seconds of the record, I knew it was a hit. Every day I'm hustling, gave me goosebumps.
Every day we hustling.
Me and him became like best friends, and it's very rare that you have friendships that last that long. Look how long me and him still brothers, still talk every day, still make music every day. I A&R'd damn near almost every single album of his. You know what I'm saying? So what I'm trying to tell you is, usually when you become successful like that and you climb that mountaintop, you know what I'm saying, people try to divide and conquer. Not us, but people, they try to divide and conquer. You can't do that with a Ross and Khaled. It ain't happening.
War is raging on the streets of Miami. A war that's leaving a trail of death.
Shit! Cut it off, that's my shit! That's any nigga that hustle, that's our national anthem right there.
The Runners right here, Main Zane, Drew Brett. Big shout out to DJ Khaled, you know what I mean?
We actually had given it, I believe, to Atlantic Records at the time, and then they had passed it down to Slip and Slide. And he had either got it from them or maybe from E-Class, I'm not even really quite sure.
And then like a week later, it was all over everywhere.
Even if your job don't even require no hustling. Even if you a librarian. Just play that shit at the library, see how that shit feel. You just in the library.
Every day I'm hustling, 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 hustling. Every day I'm hustling, every day I'm hustling.
Shit! Turn it off, sir. Don't play it again.
It just had its own vibe to it. And it was real raw, it was true, you know, and it connected with everybody that ever hustled. In any way, in the street, out the street, it was just an anthem for everybody.
Every Day I'm Hustling came out, and it was a shift. It was a new day for the city of Miami. It was the birth of a new movement.
Ross would come out of town, like come to New York or LA, and that hustling is like a tornado. We'll rip through this every day, I'm hustling,
Before it even was known, the DJs were supporting it. From that point on, I watched the momentum just pick up.
I'm saying if you went to heaven and they were playing that song, you know it's finna be a party in heaven. You just walk in heaven.
Every day I'm hustling, 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 hustling.
I remember when we first met him after Hustling and really met him, we all just pretty much hugged because we were like, just like we did it, you know what I mean? Without even kind of knowing each other, we just had that immediate like love, you know what I mean?
When I heard the record, he was, you know, every day I'm hustling, I was like, damn, I was like, woo, that boy got one right there. And when I seen the video, I think that like you seen the video like the same week that I heard the record.
Everybody thought Miami was just South Beach. He showed you the other side of the bridge.
What was you riding in? Because you are a car, you the car man. What you pulled out right with? What was you riding in when you was making that album?
You know, before my album came out, you know, before my record took off, I was riding in that white 745 LI that I actually had in the video for Every Day I'm Hustling.
Right.
I really wanted, after I got a seven-figure advance, I still wanted to drive that car in that video for everybody in that city that knew what that car represented when they seen it.
Some people can't make it past the first single. Some people can't make it past the first album.
Some people can't make an album. You know what I'm saying? Some people get gassed up and run into that brick wall and they play themselves. Not us. We so grateful for our opportunity to get in the game that we ain't never gonna stop to secure the bag to feed our families.
Did you feel pressure with the overwhelming success of Hustling? Did you feel the pressure to complete that album and make it stand up as much as Hustling was at the time? Because that was a big joint.
I sure did. I love pressure, and the first time I felt it, I became addicted to it.
Explains a lot.
It's like, is this what pressure is?
That's all?
When everybody looking at you and want more? Well, I got you.
Right on.
I'm gonna come through. And that's what it's about, delivering. You know, you really love the art and the music. It's like, yo, we under pressure, that this what it is. We gotta have it in by a certain time and this and that. That's when I work the best.
Designer jeans and a handful of dough. Bottle of that rosé, pass me some gold.
I got
more cars,
more flow,
more slow.
More money means more dough too.
Below was just, it was just that talk, man. We took one of his lines from Every Day I'm Hustling and we turned it into a hook. And it was just that talk. It was that big boy talk, man. It was just, you know, we grew up listening to Big, B.I.G. And B.I.G. would just, you know, make you, he would paint a picture so clear for everybody that was trying to hustle, everybody that was trying to come up, you know, to achieve great success and, you know, push them big whips and, you know, wear the nice Versace and the Jewels and the Rolexes and all the shit you dream about doing when you were a kid. You know what I'm saying? That's what Blow was all about, you know, coming up. And it was that shit in the club that would bump and all the hustlers would go crazy, but it was still sexy enough for the girls. And you know what I'm saying? I got a chance to sing on there and do my whole, that Blow. Like, you know what I mean? The opportunity to stunt. So, you know, we love that.
Beat Nova Cage. I wear the gun like a girdle. Bulletproof car got me feeling like a turtle.
Port of Miami, the album, I got a chance to produce a song on Port of Miami. You know what I'm saying? You know, I'm a G, you know what I'm saying? And yeah, and it's like, that's when my Beat Nova came days, you know what I'm saying? Like, my studio in the garage, Ross would come in the studio, he recorded I'm So Hood there, he also recorded in Po' Boy studio. You know, Ross was, you know, he a real dude.
When it comes to production and sound, I have no particular, you know, direction I want, you know what I'm saying? I'm just listening to the beats for colors. Let's just paint the wall, you know what I mean? And that's what we got to do.
In the early 80s, most Haitian immigrants were unskilled laborers who had to work two or more jobs just to meet basic family needs.
A lot of homies ask, what's a prayer? A prayer's what kept me focused 12 years. A prayer's what saved me. I should have been indicted. Now my kids know Jay-Z.
How did the concept for prayers come about?
That just came, that was an obligation that I made to myself, that when I got that opportunity, or if I ever had that opportunity, I'd make sure my level of appreciation and being grateful was known.
At what point did you record that record?
Knowing me, maybe halfway through the album, once I knew it was really happening. You know,
okay.
It's really going down. I got a debut album that's finna hit the streets. I'm finna put this prayer on here. I got this Dope Boy song on here, but I'm finna put this prayer on here too, though. Because we ride with the Bible on the dashboard. After you know, you go through your long day, you go through a lot of different emotions, your ups, your downs, your this, your that. You know, before you shut it down, you know, throw one up to the big homie. Pray you wake up in the morning.
And you know, I took it as a fan. I'm a friend, but I'm a fan. I took it as so clever because it's a prayer. So it is certified platinum. Out of the millions of people who've heard the album, every time they put that album on, a prayer from Rosé goes to the universe. So we'll always keep a prayer going musically, man.
And if you're watching this, I pray you rich forever.
But he had to make his Atlanta run because, you know, we was like scorching hot back then. You know, just like we are now. And he was like, I need something triumphant. I was like, So then I was like, okay. So we came up with the You're now tuned in to the very best.
I've been living out here 10 years, but I've been coming here for like damn near
96, 97.
And I used to see you in the like the tapes in the flea markets.
Right.
Like, how was that attitude like? Sticking with to the guns, because it had to be some rough times, I'm sure.
Of course it was. You got to realize, you know, at that time, you know, all the bitches shaking ass was our tempo down here. Miami was built on fast money, partying, shit like that. And my music was nigga trying to get a million.
I was a huge fan of the movie Scarface. I would watch it regularly as the type of movie. It wasn't the type of movie I've watched once or twice. It's the type of thing where I just would watch it on a regular basis. In my mind, I just saw him as kind of like a new Scarface in a way. Or there was just something that that was related in my mind. So I wanted to do a song for him that would really, that he would connect with, that would make sense, that kind of like ties in where he's from and, you know, the roots of that and what he's talking about. You know, the original song has this like disco, like early 80s kind of thing to it. When I heard that lyric, you know, push it to the limit, I was like, okay, that just, if I snap that one vocal, that just really represents, you know, that could mean anything to anyone, but it really represents the struggle, the come up.
And I think the texture of the music that was put together on the project, it just felt like a Scarface movie, you know what I'm saying? I think what also brought that feeling was the Push It record, because it had the Scarface, that song, you know, that was when Scarface was in buying the Porsche and buying, you know what I'm saying, that's when he was balling out, push it to the limit.
You know, Scarface is like a way of life for us in Miami, meaning like, you know, we from Miami, and it's such an iconic movie with such an iconic actor, and it's like, you know, is it fictitious? Absolutely, but it's kind of based on real life.
This ain't no just drop an album with some marketing. Them lyrics are real, man. I seen it, man. I was with him every day.
It's Dade County, man. This ain't no regular. This is the movement. And, you know, we're making a movie. The problem is the movie's a real movie. Listen.
Somber news in the world of hip-hop. Friends, family, and colleagues are still reeling at the loss over the weekend of Def Jam Executive Vice President Shakir Stewart. Stewart was pronounced dead at a Marietta, Georgia hospital on Saturday. Atlanta police have determined that he died from a self-inflicted gunshot wound.
How instrumental was Shakir for this album, God Bless the Dead? You know, that was my road dog, and homie just, he played just so many different things. Not only was he, an exceptional A&R, you know, exceptional production, you know, recruiter, you know, whatever it was Shake did, you know, it was all around the board for me, because I ain't really have to do nothing but get money and make my music. And big homie, you know, I'll never forget the night he brought me I'm the Boss.
Right.
You know, that was the only record other than Every Damn Hustling, which was on my first album, the only album on my second album, Triller.
Right.
Which came with a chorus I didn't put together or I didn't do, right, which was Shakir's work. So rest in peace to Shakir. Shout out to T-Pain.
Let your weed blow in the wind, cause believe every D-boy need a friend.
When can we get away and enjoy it, get away and explore it,
God bless the dead, Shakir. Actually called me, it was a good friend of mine, he called me, he was like, man, I need one of them records. He's like, he said I needed one more chance for Ross. I said, all right, man. So maybe like a couple hours, I whipped up something, sang the hook, sent it to him, man, and we got Getaway. I know he was gonna have, you know, the street records and the records like that, but I just wanted to give him a feeling, something for the ladies, because I know he's a likable man, you know what I'm saying? So for me, it was just a record like, you know, it's talking to your girl, like, when can we get away? Just get away from all of this stuff and enjoy each other. Get away and zone out and get away and get tunnel vision between you and I.
War is raging on the streets of Miami, a war that's leaving a trail of death.
This gun was not acquired and purchased by this group to go out deer hunting.
To ricochet the bullet up here,
and the victim was hit multiple times, including a number of rounds fired at close range after he'd fallen down.
You are looking at what these gangs are fighting over. Turf.
What was the last song you recorded on this great album?
Push It to the Limit.
Wow. And I hear the strain in the voice too. You was getting a lot of money right there. Yeah. Everybody pick up your Port of Miami. Listen to that Push It to the Limit.
That's a fact.
He recorded Port of Miami with no voice throughout like that whole process because he was booked 7 days a week. And Ross ain't a regular performer. Hustling was a hype song. He was in there, whip it, rip. Like he would, you know, like go look at the footage.
Between Hustling and Chevy Riding High, he was like
everywhere. He was picking up bags. Just like the Push It to the Limit, he was picking up bags. So when we did get him in the studio, sometimes his voice would be hoarse.
The man used to come to my crib, record something, jump in his car, catch a flight, do some shows, come back, land out right after the airport, go straight to the studio.
The way that he found time to record that album and still go out there and hustle and handle his business is really a tribute to his work habit. You know, he's one of the hardest working people I know.
You got the immigrants and the poor people.
When you live in these kinds of conditions, no electricity, no running water, as you can see, 90% of the buildings are boarded up.
At what point do you get tired of eating spam? I want to stay.
Every day I'm hustling, every day I'm hustling, every day I'm hustling, every day I'm hustling, every day I'm hustling.
Port of Miami, that's his first album, and he's done records with Jay-Z, Kanye West, the list goes on. These people don't just rap with people because they want to rap with people. You know what I'm saying? They rap with people because they know that's a special one, and he's special. Ross Special Cloth Alert.
Who you haters think you talking to? I'm the fucking boss. White on white, G4, hater get lost.
One of the most special times was, you know, when Jay-Z got on the remix, because that was just like, I mean, I'm a Jay-Z fan from a kid, you know, since I've been a kid. So I always dreamed of having him on one of our songs.
How did you feel when you got that first whole remix on Hustling? Because that was the start of huge records throughout the years you guys been doing. How was the feeling, dog? How was your swag when you heard that whole, when you heard that whole on that Runner's beat coming straight out of Kara City, man?
That was game changing. Mm. Every damn Hustling and remix, Young Jeezy, Jay-Z. By far that was the biggest record.
Right.
Maybe not only that year, but the year after. You know what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
Because it really spoke to the hustlers, and we all were hustling all around the world, and it was just that era, it was just that time, and it was just a perfect fit. I never forget me and Jay. This was before my second album even came out. Me and Jay went to Philippe's. We went up in a private room and we sat at the top, and you know what I'm saying, we ordered champagne and we was just talking, and you know, I asked him a couple questions about the recording process, and he gave me a gem, and he told me, when I listen to the beat, I don't listen to it for if I like the beat. Mm-hmm. I listen to it for if I can make it work.
Message.
It ain't about if I like it or not. Can I make it work? That's the way I'm gonna approach it. My pin game changed ever since that day.
I could imagine.
You know what's funny about your story is I heard you were signed to Atlantic first, and then they dropped you or something. Then you went to Def Jam, and then Atlantic is who gave you your label deal.
No.
Wasn't signed to? Okay.
So what it was.
Okay.
Slip and Slide, who I was signed to, that's who they had distribution through,
right.
Was Atlantic.
Yeah. Okay.
So everything they was putting out would go through Atlantic. When they took my music to Atlantic, Atlantic passed on it. So I had never been signed to them, but what it was all they was used to getting was, you know, that up-tempo trick, Trina. Right. And then when some nigga came in talking about, this nigga talking about, yeah, yo. All
right.
I don't know about that shit.
Putting them words together, too.
Yeah, and most definitely the wordplay. Right. So, you know, they move slow on that. And I wasn't even tripping.
Ross was ahead of his time because we from the South. Ross was, you know, Ross from the South, but he can rap. Meaning as in, I'm not used to hearing that unless you from New York. You know, not saying he sound like that, I'm talking about he was rapping, too.
He had a knowledge of the East Coast hip-hop, you know what I mean? He had that within, and I think that's important. So, like, especially from, like, the lyrical side, like, you know, you could tell he loved Nas and Coogee Rap, and, you know what I'm saying, Jay-Z, you could tell he liked those guys because he was a mirror image of that core.
He's so important to the city because it was a change, a lyricist, you know what I'm saying? A new big boy, so important.
And that's a fat boy with a beard, you know what I mean? Straight from the streets.
You ushered in a new era, especially in the rap game, but across the board, with the brothers rocking these beards, these big, thick beards, your signature style.
You know, it was a time where you didn't see as many beards, but I think us just being brothers, it's just a beautiful thing. And I don't even want to take credit for that because it was, you know, you always had, you know, myself and Philadelphia Freeway, and there was some other dudes. And,
Free.
You know, they, you know, it's just good to see brothers represented.
Heavy D was the first big dude who made big guys want to get sharp. Then after that, Biggie, you know what I mean? When Biggie was hot, you saw a lot of the boys who could afford it went out and got them coochies, you know what I mean? But when Ross came out, you saw a lot of big dudes letting their beards grow out.
His flow, his lyricism, for me, it was kind of like a new Biggie because he was super, super lyrical, but the flow was kind of, it was like a slower flow, like everything that he says like has so much like meaning and presence.
His rhymes got so much meaning to it, you know what I mean? Especially that album.
You know, I most definitely wanted people to know that the wordplay was A1 top tier, Biggie's boss.
Ross will hit you with four bars very clearly with a tone in his voice, and you might break out in a sweat.
When I did records like Bam Bad, you know, B for the nanima nanima nanana, A for the anima nanima, D for the diddy-ba-do-di-ba-da-da-da, D-di-di-da-da-da-da-da. But it, you know, it was just all about, you know, letting them know I could do it however I want to do it, you know what I mean? We could do it, you know, me being a fan of both coasts, me studying the game, and my finesse and my swag is on 5,000, you heard me? I could give you a voucher, you heard me? So everybody that's tuned in to Revolt right now, that's getting this exclusive whole slab, Renzel, interview, go online, revolt.com, ask for Renzel, Whole Slab, and Puff Daddy, and we gonna give you a voucher to start this interview all over, you heard me? We the biggest.
We are.
I'm strapped, nigga, what you want?
Just saying, fellas, if your relationship ain't working right, stop fucking your woman to slow songs. Fucking to some gangster shit, just as soon as she walk in, just...
Every day I'm hustling.
She could be like this. Nigga, I gotta go to work in the morning.